Last week I did a video on German logistics, and while most of you understood the point I was making, and I got a lot of praise for that, I also got pushback from a vocal minority. They said that I ignored the Soviet logistics, or the Allied logistics, and asked why didn't the Soviets suffer the same problems as the Germans then. They even said that Soviet logistics were far better than the Germans, the implication being that because the Soviets got to Berlin, this supposedly proves that the idea of the economic calculation problem is just wrong. Therefore, money bad, statism good, all hail Stalin. But what's interesting is that this is the same question that my patron Nikolai asked me way, way, way before I even made last week's video. It's almost like I second-guessed what the criticism would be and so planned this video to come out directly after last week's video so that I could address it. Seriously, my critics are so blatantly obvious that I can predict what they're going to say before they've even said it. Here's Nikolai's question. It is well documented that the poor road net and rail net of the East put a lot of pressure on the German logistics train, and the further the Germans came from Germany during Operation Barbarossa and Fall Blau, the more horrible the supply situation became. However, I've come to wonder how Russia did not seem to suffer the same logistical problems. Even though the ground had been scorched during the Red Army retreat, Germany had put extensive effort into converting the railway, which must have annoyed the Russians too, going west, the Soviet destruction of the oil fields in Caucasus, and, I presume, the poor road net only getting poorer after practically being fought on twice, going west to east and east to west. How did the Russians overcome the logistical problems and the Germans did not, especially considering the Germans came closer to their supply lines the further they fell back? Was it just the power of the American Lend-Lease program practically supplying the Red Army with an army of trucks? I'm not going to go over the German bit again. I'm going to be assuming everyone has seen last week's video first before watching this one. So if you haven't, watch that one first, then come back here. The link is in the description. But essentially, the same problems apply to the Soviets as they did to the Germans. They faced the same weather, the same terrain, the same distances, the same economic calculation problem, the same everything, if not more. Due to the shortened length of the European railway ties, the Soviets actually had a far more difficult time converting the European gauge to the Soviet gauge in 1944 and 1945 than the Germans did in 1941-42. When they put the rails to the gauge, this moved the rails further to the end of the ties would weaken and led to instability and derailment. And yet, unlike the Germans, the Soviets successfully reached the enemy's capital and took it. The Germans failed to get to Moscow and failed to take the Caucasus, yet the Red Army was able to reach the Elbe. Therefore, the Soviets must have been better at logistics, right? No, for starters, you have different circumstances. 1. The German army was defeated on Soviet soil. A major logistics problem for an army is the distances involved. The further you go, the harder it is to supply the troops. Well, the Soviets fought for 3 years on their own territory. At Stalingrad, the workers drove their unpainted tanks directly out of the factory into battle. So, one of the big problems that logisticians face was overcome for them. They defeated the German army before they had to deal with the distance issue. 2. By the time the Soviets got to German territory, the German army, and really the entire nation, was already beaten. The Germans had faced a Soviet nation in 1941 which had only just entered the war and had manpower and resource reserves. By late 1944, when the Soviets entered German territory, the German army was on its last legs. Old men and young boys therefore weren't putting up as much resistance as you would think against the Red Army. Yes, the Germans had some elite formations, but the point is that they were depleted overall, and so I would argue that the Germans faced stiffer resistance in 1941 and 1942 from the Red Army than the Soviets did against the Germans in 1944 and 1945. Less resistance means less consumption of supplies, and thus causes less strain on logistics. 3. Also, by the time the Soviets reached German soil, the Germans were fighting a two-front war, technically a three-front war, against the Western Allies in both the West and the South. This hadn't been the case with the Soviets in the East. Yes, they kept some units in the Far East, but they weren't fighting there, and could redeploy them westwards, which they did. This means that a large portion of the German army wasn't fighting the Soviets in the East, but was fighting the Western Allies in the West and South. They were also getting bombarded from the air, forcing them to strip their divisions of 88mm guns to use them to stop Allied bombers back in Germany. Again, this reduced the amount of resistance in the East against the Soviets, and less resistance means less consumption of resources for an advancing army. 4. The Germans were suffering from a major fuel crisis because of the lack of oil. This forced them to rely on horses and trains, and to stick to the railway lines, causing them delays of days, weeks, even months at a time, while they waited for oil trains and supplies to catch up to them. This was made substantially worse when the Soviets overrun the Romanian oil fields on the 2nd of September 1944. The Soviets had substantial oil fields, and didn't suffer from a shortage of fuel. This meant that they didn't just use horses and trains, but also a lot of trucks. They didn't have to stick to the railway lines, although it obviously helped, and so they had more logistical capacity. It doesn't mean they were more efficient with that capacity, it just means they have more capacity, and thus more margin for error, than the Germans did. Trucks made it possible to increase the distance from the railhead to the front line. Horse-drawn wagons carried a load 30 kilometers per day. The most efficient system was one day out and one day back, because the horses needed stables every night. 2 days each way, or 60 kilometers, required a third set of stables. But the trucks could travel at least 100 kilometers per day. Therefore, the practical distance from railhead to the front using trucks was over 100 kilometers, and could be extended to 300 kilometers without much difficulty, as the trucks did not need cover at night. 5. Lend-lease. Now, I know there's going to be Soviet aboos screaming at me about this. In fact, they were screaming at me in last week's video, and they say stuff like this: lend-lease wasn't a factor. Which is simply false, or that lend-lease didn't really get going properly until 1944. Right, well, the bulk came from 1943 onwards, but 79,000 motor vehicles, not including tanks, were delivered in 1942, which obviously helped the logistical situation. Stalin is noted as requesting transport vehicles in September 1941. The Soviets had converted many of their truck factories into light tank factories by 1942, reducing the amount of trucks they were producing. And 173,000 motor vehicles were shipped to the USSR in 1943. To put this in perspective, the Soviets produced 130,000 trucks themselves throughout the war, so received more trucks via Lend-Lease in 1943 alone than they built themselves. In total, throughout the war, they received 409,000 trucks and 47,000 jeeps from the USA through Lend-Lease. The Soviet command won many of its 1943 victories by being able to move, concentrate, coordinate, and sustain large forces. The value of Lend-Lease motor vehicles and communications equipment in these operations is evident in many respects. While Soviet writers rarely mention domestic motor vehicle production quite low, motor transport is described as generally improved, handling almost twice as much as in 1942. This was, in large part, due to foreign aid. It is noteworthy that Soviet references to Lend-Lease almost invariably mention motor vehicles. The point is that Soviet logistics were massively helped by Lend-Lease. Lend-Lease supplied the boots that marched to Berlin, 14.5 million pairs in 1942-43 alone. And an enormous amount of trucks, let alone tanks, trains, tractors, motorcycles, food, petroleum products, and other equipment. And while you may argue that Lend-Lease didn't get going until 1943 or 1944, the point is that the Soviets were still fighting on their own territory until then. In terms of logistics, they didn't need the trucks that Lend-Lease supplied to get to Berlin until 1944 and 1945.
Aid in the first 11 months of 1944 totaled $3.16 billion and included 144,000 motor vehicles. In August 1944, tight shipping caused a drop in truck deliveries, which fell from a monthly average of 10,000 to less than 7,700, half of the maximum, to the distress of the Soviet government. Petroleum supplies and machinery almost tripled.
Without Lend-Lease, the Soviets probably still would have got to Berlin anyway, but it would have taken them a lot longer, at higher casualties, and they wouldn't have got there until 1946 at the earliest.
These trucks solved one of the Red Army's greatest deficiencies, the inability to resupply and sustain mobile forces once they had penetrated into German rear areas. Without the trucks, each Soviet offensive from 1943 to 1945 would have come to a halt after a shallower penetration, allowing the Germans time to reconstruct their defences and forcing the Red Army to mount yet another deliberate breakthrough attack.
Bottom line, regardless of what the Soviet Abu trolls like to claim, Lend-Lease expanded the logistics capacity of the Red Army, giving them a wider margin for error than the Germans did. And 6. Central Europe has a better road and railroad system than the Soviet Union did. This benefited the Germans in the defense, but it also benefited the Soviets when their trucks raced to Berlin. It helped their capacity. Of course, the Germans did destroy as many bridges and railroads as they could during the retreat, but this just compelled the Soviets to rely more on the roads, which they could because of their trucks, something the Germans couldn't do in 1941 and 1942.
Given the destruction of the railways, the Soviet forces were heavily dependent on imported motor vehicles. Red Army rifle units supported by US and British trucks were able to sustain a winter attack 350 kilometers, 200 miles from their railhead.
And there's plenty more reasons than the ones I've listed here. The point is that Soviet logistics had advantages that the Germans didn't, which is why they were able to beat the Germans and get to Berlin. This doesn't necessarily mean that their logistics were more efficient than German logistics were. It just means that they faced fewer problems and could throw more resources at the problems to overcome them than the Germans could. But yes, they did face many of the same problems the Germans did. At the beginning of the war, the Soviets faced the exact same economic calculation problem I described in my German logistics video. Don't believe me? Well, here's a historian spelling it out.
At the beginning of the war, the supply services under the direction of the general staff calculated the needs of the various units. I would love to know how exactly they calculated this, since, after all, just like healthcare, the needs of an army in battle is basically infinite. The staff then issued orders to factories and other suppliers for weapons, clothing, food and supplies. The supply service prepared the item for shipment based on requisitions received from the front. The military transport service was responsible for delivery of the materials. Yeah, sounds great. Except, the system failed in the early months of the war, in part because the general staff was too busy with operations to direct the supply services.
Really? Too busy, were they? Too busy to calculate an impossible calculation, perhaps? Now, to be fair, they were facing a lot of problems, but those problems didn't go away even after they reorganized the system in the August 1941. They now set up a centralized logistics organization under the main directorate of the Red Army Rear. This had 16 different commissariats providing various supplies and was tasked with improving the supply situation. Krulev, the guy in charge, did reorganize the entire supply system. He reduced the number of service units in each of the army's divisions and other units to ease the logistics strain and reduce the number of depots. He also tried to reduce waste by making the transport personnel responsible for delivery. Many were put on trial and punished, suggesting that it was a lot of waste and it wasn't running as smoothly as they would have liked. Krulev also did other things to get the supplies moving to the front, but we know it didn't work, because even at Stalingrad, deep inside Soviet territory, close to their own supply base, supplies weren't reaching the troops. And this wasn't just a case of production shortages. For Operation Uranus, trains reached the front, but sat for several days at stations or even just along the tracks, waiting for their supplies to be unloaded. This was because the supply services couldn't cope with the volume. Now, the offensive was successful, but that's probably because the Soviets had months to prepare for it.
The station nearest Stalingrad, Aktuba, was incapable of handling the large amounts of supplies and troops. Therefore, the trains unloaded along the stretch of railroad north of the station.
There was a single railroad leading to Kursk that was so poor that they had to use horses to pull the freight cars because the rails couldn't support a locomotive. In 1943, the State Defense Committee blamed the front headquarters for the supply problems, showing that they were having supply problems, and noted that corruption within the system was widespread.
Some officers substituted poorer quality food, for example dried eggs for meat and flour for vegetables, and sold the meat and vegetables on the black market. Officers found guilty of infractions faced trial and assignment to penal battalions. Such draconian measures were a clear indication that the offence was widespread. It also suggests that meat and vegetables were in high demand on the black, aka free, market, due to the lack of food in the Soviet Union's official, aka socialist, command economy. It wasn't a real economy. I've been over this in previous videos, but this is just more evidence that the socialist economy wasn't meeting the needs of its citizens, aka slaves.
Railway workers were put under military discipline and sentenced to penal battalions if they refused to work, suggesting that some did refuse to work or just didn't have any incentive to work hard under the Soviet economic regime. Paradoxically, it may be the case that the Soviet logistics improved as they moved further away from their supply base. The reason is because
after July 1943, the Soviets began to regain the north-south lines, which gave a higher degree of flexibility in moving units and supplies. Before the summer of 1943, a movement of supplies or troops usually involved going first to Moscow and then to the threatened area in what was essentially one-way traffic, fully loaded cars one way and empties returning. The farther west the Russians moved, the better the rail network and lateral movements became easier. Massive transfers of units from one sector to another became possible.
There are statistics from 1944 showing that a German division was being supplied 845 tons of ammunition, which was almost three times as much as a Soviet division. And in this case, the German divisions in question had half as many men as the Soviet divisions at this point. So the amount of ammunition per soldier was significantly less for the Soviets. This doesn't suggest that Soviet logistics was a well-oiled machine. There is also evidence that the Soviets, just like the Germans, didn't load their trains properly, wasting capacity, and the Soviets had to stop numerous times because they had advanced too far and their logistics couldn't keep up. I gave a good example of this at the beginning of the Kurland series, where the Soviets barely reached the Baltic Sea near Riga, had outrun their logistics, were counterattacked and forced back, and had to wait for supplies to come up before attacking again. But there are more examples.
A faltering supply system had a detrimental impact on operations. In September 1944, the first White Russian offensive bogged down because the fuel shortage inactivated the tanks. Supplies of artillery shells had to be transported hundreds of kilometers from depots far behind the front. The Soviets also wasted a lot of the lend-lease that they received. All this equipment greatly contributed to the mobility and survival of the Red Army. Unfortunately, many of these materials deteriorated because they were poorly maintained or wastefully stockpiled due to Soviet carelessness and, the inefficient state infrastructure. That's not me saying that, that's another historian saying it. I agree though.
And the Soviets received this help for free, basically. They only paid back a fraction of the cost for Lend-Lease. In gold, by the way. You know, that relic of the past? Wonder why they didn't just pay it back in paper. So I think that answers your question, Nikolai. But I also got more comments in last week's video that I want to address as well. Things like the cost of healthcare, privatization, monopolies, how I'm blinded by my ideology, and blah blah blah. I know people tell me to ignore the trolls, but not all of them were trolls, and these are issues I actually want to address because I want to stick it to the stick-to-tanks camp. I'm not going to do it in today's video though. Instead, I will address them in future videos. In the meantime, here is a great and short video by Econ Clips that I think you should all watch on how monopolies are created. Check it out. Thanks for watching. Bye for now.